Hey everyone, welcome to episode 55 of the Gig Life Podcast. I'm your host Stevie Taylor. Welcome to the show. Hope you're well. I'm battling a bit of a cold at the moment, but anyway, as always, I'll be okay. Now, I just wanted to mention to you, I've created a Gig Life Podcast guests playlist on Spotify. Basically what that is a whole bunch of tracks, songs that feature all the guests on the Gig Life Podcast, be it artists or if they've played, you know, played instruments on the tracks or backup vocals or lead vocals or whatever. So there's a whole bunch of songs currently on there now, and I'll be adding to the playlist all the time. So yeah, go check that out. The link to that is in the show notes, or go to the website and in the news section there, there's a bit of a link to it too. So yeah, that'd be cool if you go check that out. Now, for today's guest, we're heading back across the ditch to New Zealand as I chat to Danny McCrum. Now, as you know, this podcast is not just confined to Australia. Being a New Zealander myself, I feel it's important to highlight Kiwi artists and musicians as well, and of course, go the All Blacks. Now, some of the past New Zealand guests we've had, Rafferty Turnbull, Buddy Siolo, Darren Mathiasen, and Sam Trevithick of Shapeshifter. We've had Frank Cora of Cora and the Modern Māori Quartet, Metania, Chris Chetland of Cog Studios, Ian Jones of Supergroove and Alex Lloyd, Joel Shadbolt of LAB, Joe Elms, Kerry Buchanan and Chris Cook. So yeah, go back and check those ones out. Now, on with the show is Danny McCrum. My guest today is New Zealand singer, songwriter, guitarist and podcaster Danny McCrum. Now Danny has released three previous solo albums and he has a new album Hustle Bustle which is due out this September. Now I first heard of Danny whilst I was doing some research for my interview with Joel Shadbolt for the podcast. I'd noticed that Joel had previously been on a podcast before called Don't Give Up Your Day Job, so I checked it out. Now Danny co-hosts Don't Give Up Your Day Job podcast with Op Shop drummer Bobby Kennedy. Now they interview creative professionals and find out what makes them tick, so that's really cool stuff. A few months had passed and then Danny hit me up and I was like, hey, that's that dude from Don't Give Up Your Day Job. So we hooked this up. Now the day we recorded this podcast, Danny had just released his brand new single Don't Be Late from the forthcoming album Hustle Bustle, as well as talking about his music, the music industry in New Zealand and Australia. We got to chat about podcasting, which I'd never really done before, and I thought it was really cool. Thoroughly enjoyed it, and Danny's such a cool cat. So I hope you dig it. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce to you Danny McCrum. Cheers. Don't know if I should stay, stay. All right, well, I think we're rolling. Danny McCrum. Kia ora, bro. Welcome to the Gig Life Podcast.
Thank you for having me. Yeah, I'm excited.
Not too easy, man. Big day for you, releasing your new single today. Don't Be Late.
Yep.
Don't Be Late.
Second single. Yep, yeah, that's right.
It's awesome, man. I love it.
Thank you.
Yep. Listeners, Danny sent me the video a couple of days ago, so I got a bit of an insight before you did. But I guess by the time this comes out, it's already been out for a little while. So what's the day been today? You've been running around.
What's the day been?
Yeah.
I've been driving all over town, talking to different people, and it's been pretty hectic. I've got so much on this week and this weekend that I'm having to really do some careful planning to make sure it all goes well.
Cool.
but it's good. It's all good things, you know.
That's good. It's going well so far, eh?
Yep. So far, I haven't crashed.
That's good. Good stuff. Yeah. All right. Well, let's. So, Hustle Bustle is your will be your fourth album. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Cool. Yep. And that's coming out in September. This particular track, Don't Be Late, is the second single that you've released off the album. Hustle Bustle, the title track. Man, I love that track too, eh? That's wicked.
Yeah, it's been a great reaction, actually. It's sort of taken me by surprise, you know?
You
work on this thing for so long, and when you're inside it working on it, you have absolutely no idea what the reaction's going to be. You know, you're so inside it, you have no perspective.
Yep.
Every time you release something, you think it could go either way. You know, everyone might laugh at me. Or everyone might like it, you know?
Right.
So, Hustle Bustle came out and the response was just amazing. People just loved it. So,
that's great.
Stoked.
Yeah, that's really cool. Now, I haven't had a chance to listen to your earlier stuff, but sort of what sort of musical directional change have you made to this album? Or have you kind of, is it kind of sort of built towards this kind of sound that you're at now?
Yeah, it's not like I've been doing the same thing the whole time. I think this album was more focused, and I feel more like this album represents, I guess, what I've been trying to find as an artist.
Okay. You know?
I've never followed any obvious template as a musician because I don't sort of identify myself with any particular genre. So it's not as simple as like, let's go and make a rock album.
Yeah.
So I've always been trying to stick things together and come up with something new. Because I'm doing that, I guess I'm going off path, which means that throughout the albums, in my opinion, of course, being inside, I'm going to be more critical, but in my opinion, there've been successes and failures throughout the albums. There are moments I look back on and think, man, I wish I hadn't have done that.
But then
there are other moments that just came together. So what I can see looking at it internally is that each album is sort of moving towards what I'm doing now.
Sure.
But it's like trying out different things along the way. Like my second album was a lot heavier because we were sort of going that way live. So I thought, let's bring what we're doing live to the album, make it heavier.
Yep.
But then by the time we got to the third album, we were playing around more with jazz and country and stuff like that. And then my taste as a listener have changed a little bit in recent years. I've been listening to a lot more funk and R&B and things like that. So now this new album's tighter and I personally feel like this is my strongest work. So
awesome, man. Yeah. Do you have a release date in September when it's going to be?
Currently it's September 27.
Awesome. Wicked. Looking forward to that.
Yeah.
All right, man. So, all right, let's roll back to how it all began. You were born in Auckland?
Yes, that's right. Born and raised. Yeah.
Cool. And what sort of musical family? Mum and dad musical?
Very much the opposite.
Okay, yep.
music wasn't very much a part of my family, which I think it meant that when I attached myself to it, it probably made the bond stronger because it was mine. You know, it felt like a rebellion a little bit. I think there was a bit of a punk rock vibe to it for me because it was mine and I was doing it my way, you know.
Right.
It was a sporty family, if anything else, and I went to a sporty school and I was never really into sports. So it did feel like a rebellion, but it was a love affair, you know. Like when I was really young, before I had any concept of what music was, I was just so drawn into what I was listening to on the radio. And so as soon as I started picking up instruments, I had already some sort of idea of how to approach it. And I started playing guitar when I was 12, learned three chords and wrote my first song, and I was on stage a month later. So I've been there ever since.
That's awesome. So who were those early musical influences? Was it guitar? Was guitar always the thing that stuck out that you listened to, or?
Not really, no. Like my first instrument I tried to learn was a piano, and I didn't really take to it. I love the piano, but I didn't really take to it in the lessons. And I was actually interested in songs and the show, and I was actually stuck for a while on what instrument to play. You know, I couldn't work it out. I was in the of the opinion that if you were a songwriter and singer, you played either the piano or the guitar. I hadn't yet clicked that there were people like Paul McCartney and Sting that played the bass, and you know, I didn't realize there were other options.
Yeah.
And I'd already tried the piano and it hadn't gone too well, so I thought, well, that just leaves the guitar. But I thought the guitar looked too difficult to play, so then I was like, well, what am I going to do? And there was this little window of time where um, I I didn't really know how to play anything, but I wanted to write and perform. And I tried to write a couple of songs just out of my head.
Right.
And I did it. I wrote a couple of songs, but then I could never play them to anyone. So
oh, right.
It didn't work out. Yeah. So a guy in my class who's still a friend of mine, he started playing guitar. And when I saw him play, he played Paint It Black by the Stones to me one day.
Oh, nice.
And yeah. By watching this other guy who was my age, I think we were 11 at the time, play this thing, I'm like, well, if he can do it, I can do it. And that made it possible. So that's what got me to the guitar. But no, I was never like a guitar nerd. The guitar was more of a vehicle to you know, is the thing that I happened to choose to facilitate my songwriting.
Right. Okay. So there was there ever or is there any guitar heroes these days for you? Guys that you always sort of go back to for
Yeah, that there are, but they're probably players that would seem less obvious. Like one of my favorite guitar players is Dominic Miller, he's played Sting, in Sting's band for 30 years.
Yep.
Yeah. I love Mike Campbell's work in Tom Petty's band.
Yep.
And over the years I've gotten into all sorts of players, obviously, like Paco de Lucia and John Scofield and players like that. But I'm a huge funk fan as well. So often I'd be influenced by a player, but I wouldn't know who it was, you know. So I'd be like a kid listening to early Michael Jackson and listening to all that funk stuff, and I'd have no idea who played it, but it felt so good to listen to.
Yeah, you know? Yeah, still does, eh? It's some good stuff.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
It's timeless.
Yeah, you've definitely got that. There's that funk, definite funk strum going in Hustle Bustle.
Yep, for sure.
Yeah, and also, I mean, like I mentioned to you when we were messaging to set this up, the bass playing is fucking awesome, man.
He's crazy, eh?
Oh, wow, man. So good.
He's
so
awesome.
Yeah, and likewise.
Shout out to Dan Antonovich.
Yeah, cool. Awesome. Shout out, bro. Mm. And also, you know, the drums are tight. They're funky. The sound is great. Love the sound of those drums. And that bucket, that feel, oh, man. You know, that's awesome.
Yeah.
And that's kind of a staple sort of feel for me because I'm a drummer. You
right.
Know? So, yeah, I love that bucket, you know, the crash on the.
Yep.
Yeah.
He's a clever guy. He's a young guy. Jaden Lee played drums, and he's in his early 20s.
Yep.
And we recorded it fast. We didn't take 3 weeks to do that. I think he might have got that in about two or three takes.
Oh wow.
We did it fast. We took our time getting good drum sounds, but we weren't in a really like high level studio or anything, so we were using our ears a lot.
Yep.
So it came together really well.
Yep.
It's great.
Yep. And just while we're still on that track, yeah, that the outro chorus where, you know, you change the chords but the vocal melody is the same, and then there's that sort of that high harmony that comes in, which reminds me of Mike Lindup from Level 42. Have you heard Level 42? You listen to some of the sort of outro harmony stuff that he does, and he hits that.
Yeah.
It reminded me of that. It's fucking awesome. Love that song. Well done.
To me, that's like a 70s thing to do.
Yeah, you know,
A lot of those soul singers and funk singers, they'd always do those really nice high notes, and it knocks me out.
You know, like
Earth, Wind and Fire is one of my favorite bands as well. You know,
yeah, that's awesome, man. That's really cool.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about some early bands that you played in.
Sure.
Yeah. Were you playing in bands at school? Did I hear that you played in a Rock Quest band? One of the bands that.
A band called The Frankies.
Right.
When I was 15.
Yep.
I've been in and out of bands the whole way through, probably like most musicians, you know, like putting my own bands together and joining other people's bands. So I have absolutely no idea how many bands I've been in. But it's kind of, and all the false attempts as well. Like I remember when I was 13, I was in a band for a while, for about a minute with a drummer, but we couldn't find a bass player. And this particular drummer, he didn't own cymbals, so he had to play everything with just, you know, kick, hi-hat and toms, which was kind of an anticlimax.
Which can work, I suppose, in some cases, if you're the White Stripes.
Exactly, yeah, if you make it a creative thing. And the other thing that was funny about him that meant the band didn't work but it really helped me was that he had no concept of landing on the one or resolving a fill in time. So, you know, if he kicked a fill off on beat three and, you know, conventionally you'd then land on the next one, he would just do the fill for as long as he felt like it and then start the next bar from wherever he finished the fill, which might be like a bar and a half later.
That sounds like some Keith Moon stuff there.
Yeah, But yeah. So it meant that like none of the songs worked, but it taught me to,
yeah, right.
It taught me to really pay attention to the drummer, because I could anticipate when he was going to hit the one by just keeping him in my peripheral vision and just listen really carefully. And ever since, as a guitar player, I've been complimented by drummers for being good at listening to them. Which guitar players, as you would know, guitar players aren't always very good at listening to drummers. So.
Yeah.
Awesome. So that was funny. And then after that, I was in a band with a guy who played the bass, but we couldn't find a drummer, you know, reversed. But when I was 15, I joined a band with these guys who were all about 2 years older than me. Their singer had let them down, so I came in. And we wrote some songs together and entered the Rock Quest and won the Auckland finals and got through the Nationals. And so it was a pretty exciting moment. The Nationals were held at the Auckland Town Hall and it was sold out. So being 15, standing on a stage in front of this big audience like that was really cool. And what really topped it off for me is it's the venue where the Beatles played when they came to New Zealand in 1964,
yeah, right.
4 or 5, whenever they came here. Yeah. So that was pretty cool.
That's a trip. What year was that? You did the Rock Quest. Do you remember?
94.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Because I'm originally from Masterton.
Oh, yeah.
And, and we had a band and we entered the Rock Quest and we got through the Wellington Regionals. We made it through to the local finals, which was at the St. James Theatre in Wellington.
Oh, yep, yep.
And that's the theatre where Peter Jackson filmed Meet the Feebles.
Is that right?
have you seen that?
That's cool.
Yeah.
And what year was that?
I think that was 90, might have been either 90 or 91.
Okay, yep, yeah, very close.
Yeah, and that was the year that Aaron Tokono, his band, what they used to be called? I can't remember. Anyway, they ended up taking out the whole thing.
Right, I heard about that, yeah.
He's a great player.
So you...
Oh, man, go.
I was going to say, you must have been, because wasn't that about the first year that they had it? Was it about 1990 the first time they had it, or 91?
Yeah, we definitely, it wasn't the first year for it. It was probably, might have been the second or third year. I'm not quite sure.
Mm.
Yep.
Pretty early though.
Yeah, and it's still going these days, isn't it?
Yeah,
Rockquest.
I believe
still,
so.
Still kicking on, which is a great thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really cool. So what happened to that band after the Rockquest?
Well, that's a good question, because at the end of that year, I was fully excited about what we're going to do next. You know, part of the prize we won was to record at York Street at the studios. And so we did that and we'd played some other gigs and around town and whatever we could get at the age of, you know, I was 15. And then I said to the guys one day, what about next year? Why don't we do this and do that? And I had all these plans worked out. And one of them sort of looked at me and goes, you know, at the end of the year, the band's over, right? And I'm like, what? Why? And, you know, like, we've obviously got a good thing going. Like, why would we wrap it up? And he goes, well, two of us are heading off. You know, they were in the last year of school and I hadn't thought of that. And they were going to uni, you know. I was the young guy, you know. So I was getting left behind. So they all left, and I was like, oh great! Now I don't have a band. So that was the end of that. That was a great disappointment though, because I really loved playing with that band.
Yeah, how involved were you in the songwriting for that band?
Well, it was. I've always been a very prolific songwriter, and so that was always something that I sort of automatically, what would you say? Like I automatically just sort of become the songwriter if I'm in a band usually. Because I joined their band and they were older than me, I didn't have the same kind of sway when I joined the band. So it actually took them a while to realize that I wrote. And there was an occasion where we were trying to get some songs ready for something, some performance or something. And we were short of a song and we were scratching our heads trying to think of a song. And eventually, after way too long, I said, well, you know, I write songs. And they kind of went, oh, you do? Well, play us one. And so I did. And they were like, that's a great song. What have you been keeping this for us for? You know? So we wrote a few songs together as a band standing in the room to get, you know, one of the most collaborative bands I think I've probably been in. And then to complete the set, I just gave them the rest of, you know, my songs basically. So
yeah, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was cool.
Yeah, that's cool. Mm. Now, so after the disappointment of that band ending and your bandmates leaving, what did you do after that?
Okay, so the next year after that, we had a couple of attempts at a new band. We eventually ended up putting a new band together with one of the guys from the band we're just talking about. He was on guitar in the previous band. He switched to bass. And we had a few other guys through, and so that was our main band for the rest of my teenage years. And I also, I started performing more solo, and I also started to randomly get session work, which I wasn't really looking for, but I was happy to get it. But it was like, I didn't sort of see it as anything significant. I'd just do it because it was fun. So I got like, because I was also playing drums and bass as well. And so I got a call from a band once, and they said, we're going on tour tomorrow, and our bass player, something's happened to him. I think he was injured or something. And they said, we've heard that you're good at being on the spot. Are you free to come on tour tomorrow? Like, never heard of them, didn't know any of their songs. And I went, yeah, all right. I just sort of had this policy that I'd say yes to everything. And I went, yeah, okay. So I rang someone and borrowed a bass and drove to the house the next day, met them all, got in the van and left. And I scribbled out a few notes, I think, and sort of winged it. And that happened. And then I got a call for something else where I was playing the drums, because I loved playing the drums. And then I just kept getting calls to play solo. So I just sort of ended up doing all this random stuff. And looking back, I can see how it really benefited me, you know?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
That's cool.
But the rest of my teenage years were pretty patchy. I sort of got refocused again when I got about the age of 20, got a new band at that point.
What do you mean patchy? Just bits and pieces and...
Yeah. Yeah, like I didn't have a plan, and I didn't know how to put a plan together, because I didn't know... I didn't really have anyone advising me of what to do. So like the band that we... That I was just talking about that we put together at the end of my teens, we made probably every mistake there is to make as a band in regards to the relationship in the band wasn't good. We got ourselves into a bit of financial trouble. We basically committed to some recordings and stuff without having a plan of how we're going to pay for it. And then to deal with it retrospectively, we got a bank loan, which is a terrible idea. And we got the bank loan in my name, which is a terrible idea as well.
Oh.
And it was, again, in the long run, it was really positive because it taught me what not to do, because we did all the wrong things at once. And one of the sort of significant stories that came out of that was that the reason why we put the bank loan in my name is because it was a three-piece. One of the guys had terrible credit and the other guy was a student. I was the only one with a job. And so I was the only one who could actually get the loan. So we did that, and just for no, I can't even remember why, but I wrote up a piece of paper that said the loan is owned by the three individual members and what the agreement was. And I asked each of the guys to sign their copy and keep a copy for themselves, sort of thing. At the time when we did that, the drummer had a huge argument with me, and he goes, we're friends, we're bandmates, we're not going to screw each other. This is insulting that you'd make me sign this. And I'm saying, like, there's loans in my name, you know, I'm protecting myself. If you're not going to screw me, you have no problem just signing the piece of paper. We argued for a bit, and then he begrudgingly signed it. We each signed our copies, we handed them around, and in protest, he took his copy and chucked it on the floor and got up and left. And so I picked his copy up and put it in my file. He was a bit like that. So the band didn't break up at that point. We stayed together for about 8 months. But then at the end of that year... we did a couple of New Year's gigs at a festival up north, and he said after the shows, I'm out. I don't want to be in it anymore. It's too hard. And we said, fair enough. It's not working out. Fine. And I said, well, there's just a matter of the debt. And he goes, no, I quit the band, so I quit the debt. And I said, well, it's not how it works. You can't just quit the debt. And he goes, well, it's not my problem. I'm not in the band anymore, so it's not my problem. And I'm like, well, what are we going to do? Like, get a new drummer and say, by the way, you owe us several thousand dollars? You know, it's not going to work like that. And it got nasty. It turned into a problem, and we got lawyers involved, and it just about went to court. And at the last minute, before we went to court, we forwarded to the lawyer a copy of the letter that we had him sign, and the lawyer wrote straight back and said, I didn't know this document existed. You're clearly in the right, and we'll work out some payments. And so he paid us back over 3 years, but at least we got it back, you know. Yeah, so I made the unpopular decision and the very unstereotypical decision as a musician of doing something, you know, like having something in writing and having it worked out properly,
yeah.
which made me kind of the dick in that situation. But it ended up working out. So I learned the lesson going forward. You know, you've got to do things properly, you know?
Yeah, right. And how old were you at that stage?
I think 18.
Right, yeah, that's some pretty forward thinking for an 18-year-old, eh?
I guess so. Looking back, I'm surprised that I thought like that. Yeah. I don't remember what made me think of it. I think I was I felt really vulnerable getting the loan in my name, too rightly too. It was a stupid idea.
As you would, yeah.
Yeah.
Now you worked as an intern in a recording studio in Auckland.
Yes, that was all at the same time. Yeah, so I dropped out of school when I turned 16, which was in 95, and I just wrote to all the studios and said, can I get a role somewhere? And one of them said yes, so that's what I was doing, yeah.
Right, so where was that studio? And obviously that probably doesn't exist now, eh?
I don't think it does. Yeah, it was on Upper Queen Street under a radio station, and in the end, I had to stop going there because they relocated all the way out in Henderson, and I lived all the way in the opposite direction. So it was like a 2-hour bus ride each way. I couldn't keep going.
Yeah. So what sort of acts were coming through there? Was it just sort of like demo type stuff, or did you have some serious albums recorded there? And what kind of roles did you have at that studio, and also towards the end?
Yeah, it was a small studio, so we weren't doing like major records or anything, but it was basically just the guy who ran the studio and me. I just ended up becoming his assistant, and we weren't working really with anyone famous. We had a guy come in from China who was apparently a pop star in China, which was, I thought was quite interesting that he decided to record in New Zealand, but so we did that, and we did a few other local artists, and we did lots of radio jingles and things like that, so... Like one of my jobs in the end was to edit together a Kiwi music show, which would all be worked out and scripted for me. So I'd get the paperwork that told me what order to put things together in. And I think we were using, if I remember correctly, the software Soundscape. Do you remember that?
Yep.
Software? Yeah. Yep. And I think that turned into something else, didn't it? Didn't it turn into Logic or something?
No, I think Logic was always Logic. There was one early, I may be wrong here. Correct me if I'm wrong. I know there was a very early incarnation of Logic,
right?
Which was across PC and Mac.
Oh, right. Okay.
And then it kind of, I'm not quite sure what happened to it. And then, personally for me, I sort of started on PC with Cubase.
Yeah.
And then, of course, sort of moved to Mac and Logic and all that sort of stuff. So
yeah,
I'm not quite sure. I'm not quite sure what that became.
Yeah, I heard that it became something, but I can't remember the story. But I remember, I mean, it was 95, so it was all pretty new. You know, the idea of recording digitally, I'd never seen it before. And the I remember we made one album where the guy basically couldn't sing. And so the studio head sent him out for lunch, and we just copied and pasted all the vocal takes from the one chorus across all the choruses. And I remember thinking, that's cheating. You can't do that. And of course, these days, that sort of thing's pretty standard. But so I had this job anyway of putting this Kiwi music show together. And I had this moment when I was out. I'd gone out one day on a Sunday with my girlfriend and a couple other friends. We'd driven out somewhere. And we were driving back. And I said, I think the show I edit is on in a minute. Do you want to listen to it? And so they put it on, and I'm sitting there feeling pretty good about myself because, you know, my girlfriend's there and we're listening to the thing that I edited, and it's, you know. And at the end of the show, a guy comes on and says, I'd like to apologize for the technical difficulties, something, and I'd screwed it up. But basically, I could never get my head around the patch board. The patch board just confused the crap out of me, and nothing was labeled. So the guy who owned the studio just remembered where everything was, but I could never for the life of me remember where everything was. And I can't remember quite what I did, but I was supposed to put two cables in for left and right, but only put one in. So it was actually just on like, just on the left side or something. That was quite humiliating, you know, and I learned through that job. I mean, I learned so many great skills and tips and things, but I also learned that I didn't want to be a sound engineer. That wasn't my passion. And there was there was a particular day, there's a great saxophonist in New Zealand called Chris Mason Batley. And he came in to do some radio jingles or something, and I had to go in and set up his mic and get everything ready. And then I came back into the control room, and I remember just sitting down looking through the window as he got ready to start. And I just had this feeling like I'm on the wrong side of the glass, you know? And I thought, this is not where I need to be. I need to be focusing on writing and recording. So when the studio relocated, I wasn't too fussed at that point. I was like, fair enough. I'll just get a job and focus on my music. Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. And yeah, like you said, that was around the time of you were having the issues with the band. Is that right?
Yeah. That was a year or so after that.
Right. So
yeah.
That band you had the issues with the drummer, did that end up carrying on or?
No.
No.
We initially we were going to carry on and then we decided not to.
So you sort that band was just
rotten from the inside out.
Yeah,
we just had to move on. The other guy were good friends, you know, sure. So it's not like we're on good terms, but it just wasn't working.
You just knew. Okay. All right. Well yeah. what next after that?
After that, there was a couple of sort of lost years of not being in a band, and I had a girlfriend for a few years and we broke up and I moved out of home and moved to the other side of the city, and I was sort of out there in the wild for a year or so with only a small circle of people around me and really not much going on. It was a relatively unhappy time, but one positive that came out of it is I had a friend that owned one of those four-track Tascam things, and he lent it to me, and I was staying in this really disgusting basement room under a flat, which was just moldy and gross, but that's all I could afford. And I used to sit in this little room with this Tascam thing and write songs and like layer up harmonies and things, mainly because I was bored, basically, and I couldn't afford to do anything. So I just recorded hundreds of songs on this crappy little thing. And I'm sure you remember those things, and there's only a limited number of times you can bounce before you have to start grouping things and whatever. And so I got really good at figuring out how to build harmonies and how to arrange songs. It really taught me a lot about using arrangements efficiently and,
right,
you know, manipulating parts properly to make them sit properly together, you know. So I accidentally taught myself some good stuff. But, yeah, I wasn't doing anything until I then moved flats again. And that one of the guys who lived in the next flat was a bartender at a bar called the Temple Bar, which in Auckland is relatively famous as a. It's not around anymore, but at the time everyone played there.
Yep.
And he invited me along to start playing there, so I started playing there, and they gave me a regular spot. And then through that, I met all these new people, and eventually put a new band together.
Yeah, great. Right. And did you record with that band?
Yeah, the new band that we put together was together for a few years, and we did all sorts of things. We made a couple of EPs, and I guess that was our first sort of professional band. Like with that band, we supported Jimmy Barnes and John Mayer,
right,
and people like that. And we started to play like bigger shows in Auckland and around the country a bit. So,
yep. And yeah. And was that the band you also supported Eric Clapton? Is that right?
No, that was quite a few years later. That was my band.
Oh, that was your band. Okay, cool. All right, we'll get to that.
Yeah, that was when I was sort of working under my own name quite a bit later. So,
all right, well, let's try and fill that gap then between that band that was, you know, doing the John Mayer support up to your band. Did something happen where, like these bands before that, did they actually have a name, or was it your name?
They all had band names. Some of them were terrible.
Right.
I was never. I never had any plans to go solo or work under my own name or anything like that. It was never an idea I wanted to pursue.
Yep.
So no, they always had names. They were always proper bands. Yeah.
Right. So what sort of led you to realize that maybe, you know, I want to do this solo. I want to do this under my name.
It was a sequence of events, and it's not necessarily a decision I always agree with. Looking back, sometimes I look back and think maybe I shouldn't have done that. But what was happening at the time was I was trying to get my career sorted out at the same time as I was trying to get my life sorted out. And so like that time in my, I guess, early 20s, you know, I was broke. I had like, I was in and out of pretty bad relationships sometimes. The band was, you know, a lot better than some of the previous ones, but it was still a little bit rocky. We were trying to, the big thing for me was I was trying to figure out how to go full time as a musician, because I just felt like working in a job all week, I was just wasting all this time, you know, which I know is perfectly normal for people. I don't look down on people who do it, but I just, at the time, I just thought, I've got to try and make a career out of this. And so I was trying to solve that problem. And in the meantime, the band was trying to get somewhere. So we were dealing with all of the challenges that come with that, the financial side of it. Like if you got to record, who's going to pay for it? You know, we're young.
Because you're not getting a bank loan. You're not getting a bank loan again.
Yeah. No, I definitely learned my lesson with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I remember, but these are very sort of practical questions, you know, like you've got four guys in a band and the recording's going to cost $8,000, let's say. Who's going to pay for it? No one has the money, you know? And so becomes messy before you've even started. And as I was just trying to problem solve all of these things at the same time. And eventually I was at the point where I was unofficially acting as manager in the sense that I was doing all the legwork, but I wasn't officially the manager. So I would say, I think we should do this next. And they would, quite rightly, they would be able to argue with me and say, no, that's a terrible idea. And I found myself saying, well, you didn't just get off the phone with the guy. The guy told me that this is the thing, you know. They were arguing based on an opinion. I was arguing based on having done the work. And I found that really frustrating. I was also becoming more and more of aware of the difference in investment of time and energy. Like, one of the guys in the band would just show up to rehearsals and the gigs.
I know exactly what you mean. Yep.
Exactly. Where I was like involved with everything all the time. And I thought, this isn't, you know, this is just not working. So when things got tense, one day I went to the guys and I said, I think I need to be officially in the role of manager. And they said, what does that mean? And I said, well, I think it means that I need to have the final say, which doesn't mean that I'm like on a power trip. It actually means I've got a lot more pressure. It's an accountability thing. If it works or doesn't work, that's going to land on me, not you. And I'm still going to include you in the decision-making, but at the end of the day, I need to be able to put a plan together and then see that plan through. Because at the moment, we keep changing our minds every 5 seconds because we're so unorganized, you know? So I need to do that. And I said it needs to also reflect on the money. There needs to be a management fee so that I can just cover my admin, pay for the website, you know, that sort of stuff. And to my complete surprise, they said, fine, brilliant. And so we changed it all around. And then for the rest of the band's life, there were no more problems. It just clicked.
Right. I thought that story was going to end up massive fight. Everybody left.
No.
Good news.
It was the opposite.
Yeah, great.
It was the opposite because, you know, then one of the guys would say, I think that we should do this. And I'd say, I'd be able to talk it through with them and say, why do you think that, you know, and we'd be able to exercise the idea. And in the end, they felt comfortable also saying, you know, and at the end of the day, it's your decision. And I had to represent them and try to do the best for the band, you know, and it just sort of took the whole argument away.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, I set up a company and I sort of worked out that things made more sense if I had a company and I was able to invoice for gigs through the company and then pay the guys as contractors and be you know what I mean, just set it up properly. Ever since I did that, everything's sort of been easy in that sense, in that area.
Yeah, right. And it's still like that today, yeah?
Yeah. I set up my company in 2005 and that's what I still do.
Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. Right, so this band was still this was under a band name, or had you put your name to that band at that stage once you sort of formed the company? And
it was still under a band name. It was called Spinner. And so the band then lasted for another year or so. Again, while I was trying to figure out how to make everything work financially so I could actually live off it, there was another guy who I'd met at the Temple Bar a few years earlier. He was an amazing singer. His name's Chris Melville. And he came up to me once and said, I've gone full-time with music. And I'm like, oh my God, I'd never met anyone who had actually gone full-time who wasn't super famous, you know? So I said, tell me everything. Yeah, tell me how you did it. and he said, well, basically, I've realized that I can't live off one area. You know, there's not one thing that I do that's going to make me a living. I'm not going to live off songwriting. The way you've got to look at it is multiple streams of income. So I'm out there as a songwriter. I also do covers. I do jingles. I do anything and everything. And across all of those things, I can put a career together. And that just switched the light on for me. And that's genius, you know? So I dropped a few of my ideals, like a lot of young guys. I don't know if you've experienced the same thing, but a lot of people are anti playing covers, for example, when they're young. And I used to be like that a bit. And I thought, well, who cares what I'm playing, if I'm out playing and making money and getting better at playing, who cares what I'm playing, you know? So I went to the guys and said, I think we should start doing covers gigs. I think we should go out there as a covers band as well as an originals band and make some money and be able to invest that money in gear and recordings and things. And one of them was quite up for it and another couple of guys were pretty against it and they went along for it with it temporarily and then it eventually broke the band up. A couple of the guys just went not into it. When that happened, I was like, you know, let's just start again. I'll call it my own name and we'll just go forward and do it that way. And I put a covers band together as well called The Buskers, which worked in parallel.
Right.
So
awesome. Yeah, cool.
Yeah, and that was my transition into going full-time as a musician.
Right. And so when did the first album with your name come out?
2007.
2007, yeah,
album called Awake and Restless. And it was funny because I started the company in 2005 and that band was done by the end of 2005. So I basically started my band and started, what's happened?
Oh, I just said, oh. Oh.
Oh. I thought you went, oh, like the recording has stopped or something.
Oh, no. I'll let you know if that happens. So that, you might see me glancing down.
Right.
Like this. I'm just, just always checking.
I'm doing the same thing, just to make sure it's still going. So the band wrapped up at the end of 2005 and I think we played a New Year's Eve gig again. I think that was the last gig we did. So something about New Year's Eve gigs. And 2006 was when I put my new thing together. And by now being out there working and playing a lot more, it worked. We were able to invest in gear. We were more rehearsed. We were tighter as a band because we were playing more. And we were bringing in more money because now it was our job to make money through music. So I actually had money to apply to allocate to recording. So my first album, I spent my money on. It was my investment and I paid the guys a session fee to record on it because it was my decision to do it.
Yep.
Which meant that I had to work my ass off to get it done and then promote it. And I released it and 10 months after release, I managed to break even and make my money back and it's been in profit ever since.
Oh, that's great. Yep.
Yeah, by making that decision, it really couldn't have worked out better, really.
Were you touring your albums, your music?
Yep, yep. The first thing we did actually with that band before we were anything was we went on a national tour. We thought, let's just do something massive and crazy just to kind of make everyone look at us. And we just booked a tour that took us from Kerikeri to Invercargill, just top to bottom of the country. We hired a 6-berth camper van and we travelled in it, we slept in it, we just drove thing like a big adventure. By the end of it, I was pretty happy to not be in that thing anymore. but it was a great adventure.
Yeah, that's cool. All right, so on to album number two, which was Say What You Mean?
Say What You Mean, that's right.
Yep, cool. Now, was that with the same bunch of guys?
Yeah, I think each album, the lineup has sort of changed just slightly. The lineup changed a little bit. Our drummer changed between albums, if I remember correctly. Our original drummer, really, really nice guy called Steve Harvey, who has gone on to do really great things. He actually moved to, where did he move to? Hong Kong or somewhere like that. And he's doing amazing things. But he said to me right at the start, I'm happy to be in the band, but it's going to be short term because I want to pursue other things. We said, great, that's fine. He just set us the expectation. I expected him to be in the band for about 6 months, but we ended up having him for about a year and a half.
Oh,
and then he came to me one day and said, I now need to go and do other things. And we said, all right, you know, gave him our best wishes and auditioned and found another guy called Glenn Child, who is another great player here. And he played on the second album. So
yeah, right, brilliant.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. And then did you tour again?
Yeah, I mean, by that point, touring had become harder because as I'm sure you know, the costs go up and, you know, so instead of touring, I guess by that point, we're more just traveling to do shows or doing pop-up shows here and there. The second album we recorded early in 2009 and released by the end of 2009. And it was quite a big year. Like that's the year that we got the support slot for Jeff Beck and then Eric Clapton. And I toured with Tom Emmanuel again. I've toured with him about four times now. And then we were flying around doing like, orientation uni gigs, you know, in Christchurch and Auckland and things like that. So we're sort of all over the place. I don't know if you call that a tour or if that's just doing lots of stuff.
I suppose it is. I mean, here in especially bands that they're in Sydney, tours these days, and I think all over Australia really, tours these days are just a fly in, fly out the weekend type thing.
That's right.
So, it's, you know, I think that's pretty standard.
If that's what we're talking about, then we're touring constantly.
but
no more camper vans.
Yeah, good stuff. Yeah. All right, so and then Led Us to the Future, that was 2012.
Yep. So a couple of years had passed and I'd sort of done a few other things and we decided to, one of the things that happened actually before that was we sort of started a new band on the side and it kind of backfired. It just sort of didn't work for a number of reasons. And in the meantime, I'd been writing all these songs which I had no plan for. I'd just written all of these acoustic songs, and I'd started to demo them with our live engineer, and eventually we thought, these songs are pretty good. Why don't we invite some musicians to play on them and we'll just see what happens? And the idea, the concept of it just sort of evolved as we went. There was no sort of one moment where the plan was put in place. Basically, we reached out to a bunch of our friends that we'd played with live and just invited them and said, we don't really know what we're doing, so why don't you just come and play whatever you want? You know, like, awesome. instead of me telling you what to play on the drums, for example, you just make up something and surprise me and make it more interesting. And so we had three drummers and three bass players and I think a couple of guest guitarists. There was a banjo, there was several guest vocalists. All of them were almost with zero direction from me, like just the odd thing here and there. Well, like, why don't you do it again, but change this thing or something. But generally speaking, everyone on that album wrote their own parts. So, awesome. So the album came out under my name, but I don't really think of it as my album. I sort of think of it as this big thing that a big group of us made together, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, that's really cool. Yeah. So what happened after that? It was a bit of a break. You took a bit of a break, did you?
I did, yeah. I mean, the truth of it is that after that, I just kind of hit a wall. I was burnt out, you know? I mean, the year Letters to the Future came out, Spotify came to New Zealand, and straight away I could see how destructive that would be for the industry. The New Zealand industry can be very difficult. It's very political. It's very small. And I'd always felt a little bit outside, you know, and I wasn't really getting the support. We'd had a record deal and stuff, but it just still didn't feel like we had really gotten the support. We were getting more support from international artists, funnily enough. Yeah, they kept asking us to do things, but the local people weren't really interested. And by that point, I'd been like writing songs and running bands for so long that I just burnt out. And there was a little window of time there. It was about 2 months long where I actually considered quitting music. I thought maybe I'd do something else. And then I realized after a bit of, you know, reflection that I didn't have to quit music completely. And what a waste that would be after all these years of, you know,
of course,
trying to get strong at it. Instead of quitting music completely, I can just sort of change direction in my career and focus more on being a session musician rather than sort of putting everything on being an original artist. Because I think that was the problem, is that while I was always doing session work and stuff, I think I just identified myself as an original artist, and my sense of whether I was successful or a failure as an individual rode on whether my music worked commercially, which made zero sense, you know? So I changed my direction to focus more on being a professional musician in all respects, and did that for a few years. And a few years later, I sort of randomly got the desire to start writing again. And so that's led up to this album now.
Right. So I'm just going to take a snippet out of your bio. So then in a random moment, walking along a street in Vienna, Austria, the muse returned. So was it an actual moment?
Yeah. That's completely true. I was walking along the street and I thought, oh, you know, I know what I can do. I just kind of heard it. I know what I want to do. I wouldn't even be able to explain it much more than that. But you know how creatively, and I'm sure every creative person out there knows what I mean, just out of the blue, you go, I get it. I know what I want to do. And that was the moment. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. And did you act on it straight away?
Pretty much. I mean, I was in Austria, so I had to wait till I came home. Yeah.
But
yeah, yeah. But yeah, yeah, no, I came home and straight away I started to demo things. And I mean, I continued to sort of casually write and then, you know, save demos here and there.
Right.
But I started to dig through the demos and what have I got, and then write more material and started making the list of that would eventually get refined down into the new album.
Right. So. And this is the music, the songs that are on Hustle Bustle. Right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yeah. And the song Hustle Bustle itself was the strangest song when I first wrote it, because I got the idea for this really weird sort of dark and twisted bass line that was going to be like this weird kind of industrial trap sort of thing. And I was really into it for a while, but I just kept sort of messing around with it. Eventually, ironically, the bass line got ditched. the thing that the song was written around. Yeah, I ditched the thing that the song was written around. And
it's a killer bass line now.
I could probably reuse it and no one would notice because it's so different. And the song eventually got sped up slightly and converted into whatever you'd call it now. I guess a funk thing or whatever it is.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So that was an early piece. Mm.
Yeah, no, awesome. All right, let's talk a little bit about your podcast.
Right.
So you and Bobby Kennedy and Bobby's drummer from Op Shop, if you don't know. Yep.
Yep.
Have a podcast called Don't Give Up Your Day Job.
That's right.
Right. So tell me how that came about. Let's talk a little bit about podcasting.
Well, for those who don't know, Op Shop were a very successful band in New Zealand. They won all these awards and hit all these records and whatever. And the band, so Op Shop broke up temporarily, and they got back together. But Bobby and I ended up working together in a show that was touring New Zealand. And so we're often just chatting and comparing stories and, you know, the usual musician thing. Long rides in the van or on a plane or whatever, and this one time at band camp, you know, comparing things. And so anyway, we kept talking about all this stuff, and just on one particular drive, he started talking about how he had always wanted to make a documentary, and he wanted to make a documentary about the real life of a professional musician, or even broader than that, a professional creative, because... Yep. Having been in this band that in New Zealand is a household name, there were all these weird moments where people assumed that they're multimillionaires, or they assumed that they're really broke, or they assumed that they're all drug addicts, or they assumed that, you know, they had guitar-shaped swimming pools, or you know what I mean? And there seemed to be a real disconnect from reality and you know, the idea of what being a rock star, for lack of a better term, meant. So he was talking about this, and he was trying to get people interested to help him make a documentary, but it's obviously quite an expensive process to do that, and it's a risky subject as well, because anyone who's going to go on there and talk about it is in one way or another going to potentially, I don't know, they might see it that they're putting themselves on the line by being honest. Yeah, in our industries, we're always trying to put our best face forward, you know.
I understand.
Yeah. So he struggled to get that going. And I said, well, why don't you avoid all of that and just make a podcast? And we had both been pretty big podcast fans. So he went, yeah. And I'm like, it'll cost us almost nothing to do. And instead of talking to like half a dozen artists for a documentary, we can talk to an endless number of people.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, and for those out there who end up listening to all the episodes, across the episodes, they'll start to pick up the themes. You know, because what I've realized is that if you talk about like how to make it or how to be successful, no one knows the answer. Because even if let's say you go and talk to some really successful artist, how did you do it? They tell you their story. Well, I started here and I did this and I met that person and went over here. You can't replicate the story because it was dependent on that time and place and who was around. And, you know, it's never going to happen again. And that's why there's no blueprint to having a career in the arts, I think. So I think the answer is to talk to as many people as possible so that you can pick up on the themes. And some of the obvious stuff rises to the surface, like having a good work ethic and being organized and that sort of stuff, you know? So that's why we started it, basically. And my experience had been similar to his, but I didn't come from a really famous band. I was my experience had been as a working musician, again, dealing with the same sort of confusing perceptions, you know? So that was it.
And so how many, you're 70-odd episodes in now, aren't you?
Yeah. I think we're up to about 73 or 4 or something.
Yeah, that's great. What's been the biggest challenge podcasting? I mean, I definitely have some challenges, and I'm sure you guys do too. So I'd like to hear what your biggest challenge is with podcasting.
Yeah. And it'd be interesting to see if we have the same challenges.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
I think... For me, early on, there was a little bit, from time to time, there's a little bit of an imposter syndrome where just talking to the odd person, you would psych yourself out and you'd think, God, I'm no one compared to this person. I've got nothing intelligent to say. You know, world famous, like killer musician or something. Well, I've got nothing, you know? Which is ridiculous because you don't have to be the same as someone to talk to them, you know.
But no,
yeah, so I'd psyched myself out on that. And learning about pacing was really interesting. You know, neither of us had a background in broadcasting. So we, you know, you learn how to not have dead air and how to think ahead, how to stay in the moment, yeah. but think of the next question yeah. at the same time. It's actually more challenging than you'd think, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And most of the people that I'd talked to up till about episode 40 or something like that, it was very flowing. And,
right.
And like yourself, you talk and I can kind of predict when the answer to the question is going to end, so I can kind of prep myself. I spoke to one guy and I would ask him a question and he'd just say, no. And I don't know if you've ever had that situation, but
oh, yeah.
that's hard, man. Yeah, yeah. But I mean, that taught me so much. I mean, yeah. by the end of that particular episode, we were flowing, man. I knew it was coming. I would change the way I asked the questions, so I had right. to get a bit more of an answer.
Yeah.
So I had time to think, you know, because likewise, I had no experience in broadcasting. Nothing like that. I'd just been a musician and a electrical fitter all my life.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, yeah. So that was a challenge that sort of come about, you know, in the last few months. But for me, the biggest challenge has been the people that have been quite demanding.
Oh, yeah? In what way?
Yeah. In having the episode have to be a certain way.
Oh.
Asking for edits and re-edits and
oh really
and then doing that and yeah there's been a couple of those. I'm definitely not going to name them. yeah, and then at the end of the day, you know, that episode will come out, but they don't do anything about it. They don't help
promote it or anything.
Not promote it. Not that I'm actively seeking that, but you know, you'd think if this person has got, you know, wants me to go to all this detail to get this sort of their product right, I suppose.
Yeah.
That they want to use it, you know. So that, and then I've had people that haven't thanked, you know, not that I'm fishing for that stuff, but
yeah, I know what you mean.
You know
though.
What I mean? Hey,
that's
kind of a kick because, you know, we do this for nothing.
Mm.
And most of the time these particular people, I've actually gone to them and if you've been to Sydney's a big place and
yeah.
you know, some of these places it's an hour to get there and an hour to get back.
Right.
At night time after a long day at work, you know, you go to hang out with this person and, you know, and get back and it's kind of a kick in the teeth, to be honest.
Yeah. No, I totally hear you. I haven't had that too much. Yeah. Like I've had the odd person.
Okay, that's good.
We offer the opportunity to take things out, like, because we don't want people to be too paranoid when they're talking. So
yeah, yeah.
We always say to them, if after the episode you're not comfortable with something you said, then by all means we'll take it out. Yeah. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, likewise, I definitely do that. But see, yeah. for me, it's been the last, like, I kind of release a similar sort of day.
Yeah.
And it's been like the day before or even on the day that person has.
Really?
after 2 weeks gone, you know. So, you know, that's difficult, but I'm getting my head around that. And the other thing that was tricky to get my head around, which I've got it sorted now, is when I would sit down. Never met that person before, and then you sit with them for an hour and a half, and you know, you get to know them on quite a deep level.
Yeah,
and then deep down, you probably think that we're now friends,
right? Yeah,
and then crickets, man, you never hear from them again. You know, that's weird. That was a hard thing to get my head around. You know, and then I just got to think about no, that's the whole point of it. Like that person wanted to sit here and tell their story for the podcast, and that's it. You know,
I guess on that level, they're probably used to doing interviews, you know, going on TV or something, doing an interview and you're not supposed to have any kind of rapport before or afterwards.
Exactly right.
You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Which is a shame. I've enjoyed actually us chatting a bit leading up to this.
Yeah.
It's been quite cool. Awesome. It kind of feels like there's already a rapport there before we start, you know, which is nice.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But we've found on one of the things that I've found is that Americans, just generally speaking, obviously, Americans tend to be very good at talking a lot, but then pausing to let you talk. Whereas I find, especially New Zealanders, they talk constantly and never let you get a word in, or they do what you were describing before, where they say nothing. They just say yes and no.
Yep.
And I find it very strange, you know, but I think maybe the Americans that we've had on the show, again, they're possibly just more used to the type of entertainment world over there where they're thinking more about pace and dead air, but also not interrupting each other so much. I don't know. It's quite interesting to see how different countries and cultures operate in these ways, you know?
Right. Yeah, totally. Yeah. I listened to your episode on Dr. Tennant's.
Yes.
And I was really fascinated by that whole topic of sort of cross-pollinating the podcast.
Yes, and that's right.
Yeah, I think it's great. And we're obviously doing that now. Mm. There's also a couple of guys here that have podcasts that we've talked about. And one of them, we're going to do like a couple of them at different times. We're going to do like a podcast together.
Right.
But then we're going to, yeah.
That's released on both podcasts.
Yeah, that's right.
Cool idea.
It'll be the same podcast, and we'll sort of share the hosting role of it as we go, you know, so that's exciting, you know.
I love that. Cool. I love that sort of thing because I sometimes have felt over the years that musicians can be also very cagey about each other and very competitive and cut each other down a lot. Yep. And I've always thought, you know, it's so hard to be a musician, and the music industry is so hard. We should be backing each other up, you know. We should exactly be we should be reinforcing each other. Like, it's up to us to... Like, we often bitch and moan about not getting paid enough for unfair treatment or bad contracts or bad playing conditions and stuff. I always just think if we all say no to something, then it will change. No?
Exactly.
But as long as we keep acting as solo pilots, we're not going to fix anything. So
yeah,
I think pulling together to me makes the most sense.
Yeah. Mm. What's with all the guests that you've had? What has been the biggest, I wouldn't say advice, but the biggest takeaway you've taken from a guest? They've said something and it had the biggest effect on you.
Wow, tough question. I don't really know. it's been really nice to get so many perspectives on subjects because it's the way that I think anyway. Like, I'm not the sort of person that develops an opinion early in a process and then just defends the opinion whether I'm right or not. I'm the sort of person that, you know, I'll keep considering something over and over again, you know. So in the time that we've been doing the podcast, quite a lot of things have happened in the world, you know. In the time since the start of 2016, of course, we've seen everything and happen in the politics in America. You know, on the early episodes, you can hear us going, "Nah, he's not going to get in. There's no way." Yeah. and then I think when he got in, I think that it was more like, "He got in? What the fuck?" You know, we couldn't believe it.
Yeah, and now it's what do we do now?
Exactly. Now it's kind of like, "Nah, he won't get in again." But now we're sort of like, "Well, he might." I hate to you know, let's hope he doesn't, but he might. And all of the other things that have happened on you know, like the Me Too movement, for example. So I think I talked about this on the Dr. Tennant podcast as well, how when some of that first happened, I think Matt Damon got criticized because he came out and said, well, not all guys are jerks. And I was saying the same thing. It's not all of us. We're not all like that. but then I kind of realized after a while that, yeah, that's true, but it's also kind of not the point. You know, the point is that there have been these things have been going on for so long and they haven't been heard or respected or recognized. It's not time for people like us to defend ourselves. It's time for us to listen. And so that I think that's probably not just with that subject, but with lots of other things. It keeps reinforcing that idea that really what we need to do to make some positive changes in the world is start listening to each other more and having more empathy and more intelligent thinking, you know? And I guess the podcast has just reinforced that for me, that none of us know everything. So we've got to just calm the fuck down, chill out a bit, listen to each other and try to work together rather than putting up walls, literally or figuratively.
So, yeah, right.
That sounds a bit political, doesn't it? Maybe I should go into politics.
Oh, classic. Yeah, Australian politics, man. I'm not touching that.
Nah. I'm so not political. I find the subject so boring.
Yeah, same with me.
Yeah.
And also I'm not a Australian citizen. So
right.
I don't vote.
Yep.
and it hasn't bothered me too much, except for the last few years. But I still haven't got around to getting my citizenship so I can vote.
Right.
So I really should do that so I can have a say, you know. But
do you use that as a kind of way of staying detached if you don't like what's going on? You kind of go, well, it's not, you know.
Yeah, I do that, but also I get in trouble sometimes if I end up having a political opinion.
Right.
And because, you know, most of the people that I know, my friends, know that I don't vote because I'm not a citizen. They just go, shut up. You've got nothing. Just shut up. bloody Kiwi, shut up. Go home.
Yeah.
So
Do you vote in New Zealand?
No. I think I, yeah. No, I don't. I should vote somewhere. I should have a say somewhere.
Should vote somewhere.
Now, just to this point, what's been the biggest lesson you've learnt in the music industry?
I think probably the answer to that is, in some ways, corny, but it's to trust your instinct. You know,
yeah, right. Sounds like you have.
Not always.
Oh,
yeah,
right, okay.
But I mean, yeah, and I guess to the most part, I've always sort of followed my own nose. But there were times in the past where I turned things down because it didn't feel right. That, you know, contracts or management deals or something, and just like, nah, I don't think so. I worked out pretty early that while we're all sort of taught to all want a record deal, record deals aren't automatically the right thing to do or the right thing to sign. You know, you've got to consider the deal on what you're going to get out of it and if it's going to work, if it's going to make your plan work better or if it's going to inhibit you, you know? So things like that. But also, even just on a creative level, there have been so many times in the past where I've second-guessed myself and I've instinctively thought I think I know how this should go, but I didn't quite have the clarity or the confidence to say it needs to be like this. And usually those are the moments that I look back on and regret because I think, I should have held my ground. And so on the new album, you know, I'm still an artist and I'm still self-critical and I still have moments of listening to something I've done and you know, questioning things. But on the new album, I feel like I just sort of put that to rest finally and said, I'm going to do this, you know. And this is the first album that I've 100% produced as well. In the past it was either an actual producer or co-production. And yeah, so I just look back and I think everything that I don't regret is when I just went for it. And everything I do regret is when I kind of hesitated. Mm. I think instinct is quite powerful. I don't believe in any kind of supernatural force or anything, but I think instinct is, we collect things subconsciously and our instinct is when that is focused into something that you should really listen to most of the time.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
Mm. Have you ever had, or do you get much support from New Zealand On Air in regards to, say, making tracks funding, or have you had anything along those lines? Have you put yourself forward to that stuff?
I have. I'm kind of laughing because I went through a phase in the early years of trying to get funding, and when we got the record deal, our label manager organised a meeting with us in New Zealand On Air. And I went to this meeting and they said, yeah, we considered you, but we decided to not support you. And I was like looking at them going, well, why are we here? I didn't get it.
Yeah.
And that kind of made me think, well, obviously I'm just not the right ilk for that area of the industry. So I ignored them after that. I didn't ignore them. I just didn't bother.
Right. Why did they call you in there in the first place then? What was the point of that?
Exactly. I have no idea. A free coffee? I'm not sure.
You still?
I don't know. Yeah, the label was paying for lunch. I'm not sure.
Oh, right. Okay.
It was
right.
Bizarre. I don't know why you'd say yes to a meeting if you've already decided not to support the artist. But anyway, whatever. So all these years have gone by since then. And I had a meeting with someone sort of in the business recently who said, Hustle Bustle's a really strong track. I think you should put it in for funding. And I was like, they're not going to fund me. You know, that's sort of been and gone. Right. And she goes, right, I think you should try. She goes, I'm not saying anything's going to, you know, it's not guaranteed, but I think you should try. It's like, okay, fine. I'll give it a shot. So I put it in and I'm now waiting to hear. So in a month or so, I might get funding. Who knows?
Yeah, right. Awesome.
It'd be cool if they supported me. I mean, I feel like I've earned it, but you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess everyone feels like that.
I'm in a band called The Company.
Yep.
And we're a bunch of Kiwi fellas. We were all in Sydney at the time, but there's a couple of us. Hang on. No, sorry, my MacBook screen just went black. So
yeah, I hate that.
Heart skipped a bit. Yeah, yeah. And we wrote the song So we've split up a little bit over the country now, but at the time we had the song and one of the guys was putting the tracks in, making tracks to see what happened.
Yeah.
And then we almost split up. We'd had this massive fight at rehearsal and we were done and sending messages going, no, I don't want to do this anymore.
Right.
Anyway, Ronnie sent this message late at night and I thought, oh, what's this? We're still carrying on, you know? And he's like, we just got making tracks funding. Wake up. And he saw that I saw it. And then he rang me straight away and he goes, we just got funding. And I'm like, what does that even mean? Like,
And did the band stay together because the funding came through?
We did, yeah, absolutely. And we got the funding for the track and the video. So yeah. We started a crowdfunding campaign here in Sydney to sort of pay for our flights over and to do it. And went and did it, and it was great. Do you know Chris Chetland?
Yes, he mastered the latest album.
Yeah, right, awesome. Well, yeah. Chris was on the panel, and he heard the song, and he kind of fought for it, you know, and then once we got the funding, obviously it needs to be, you know, voted for and that kind of thing.
Mm.
Once we got the funding, Ronnie contacted him.
Right.
And then he said, oh, well, I was on the panel actually. So yeah, I'd love to have you guys. So yeah, we flew to Cog Studios and then we went out to Revolver Studios. Yep. And recorded the drums and bass and guitars and stuff out there. And,
is that the new Revolver out way out south, or was that when it was still central?
That was when it was. What's the name of the town?
Waiuku.
Yeah, yeah, Waiuku. Yep.
Yeah, yep. That's the that's currently where it is.
Right. Where did it used to be?
Central Auckland.
Oh, right.
It used to be in maybe I think in Epsom somewhere.
Oh, right. Okay. Cool. Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, yeah, we flew over and recorded, and then 2 days later we went and did the video. And then flew home and then released it and yeah, and that was it. it was a trip, man. It was really cool.
I've never really known how it works and, you know, what really the agenda is. Not that I'm saying they have the wrong agenda, but I've just never really understood the process. And you know, I would certainly love their support. But at the same time, I do believe in being independent as an artist. You know, I think I'm very proud of the fact that I've put my career together. I've been basically It's an independent career. You know, I've invested my own money and made my own money back. I'm proving that it can be sustainable and that you can have a career in music. You know, and if I just had everything paid for me the whole way through, I don't know if that would have been, it wouldn't have made the same statement. I don't think I'd have the same sense of ownership.
I understand.
So if they do choose to support me, I'd like to think that they choose to support me because they can see that I've worked hard and that I've applied myself and that would support someone who's sort of on the winning side.
Gotcha.
Rather than giving a handout to someone who can't be bothered doing it themselves, if that makes sense.
It does.
But
yep.
I don't know how they think, so I don't know if they'd see it that way.
Yeah.
Be cool if they did, but you know, who knows.
And, yeah, quite often we would look at the, this is before and after, you know, we got our funding. We would just look at the list that got funded and we would go, well, it's a big label artist,
yeah.
Big label, like what?
Yeah.
I mean,
I know.
Yeah, it
still happens.
Yeah,
I still see names on there and think if they haven't made enough money by now to work out their own shit,
yep.
They shouldn't be given money.
Yeah.
But again, what do I know?
Yeah, it comes down to it. You know, you don't know what the agenda is. You don't know who's got what hand and what pocket, and you know.
Yeah, and I also think if it was up to me, I would make my decisions for whatever reasons I would have.
Yep.
And then be criticized the same way by all the other musicians out there. So
yep.
It's kind of an impossible job to choose, I think.
Yeah, that's it. And then I guess the other side of it too is like, you know, like we weren't actually living in New Zealand at the time and we got funding.
Right.
So there's that side of it. And we probably got a little bit criticized for that. But I mean, you know, the song that we made was five Kiwis in a room that wrote a New Zealand song, you know, it didn't matter that we were here, but
yeah.
I mean, we had all intentions of carrying on wherever it took us. We were we were promoting it hard, and if it had got traction, who knows? We would have moved home, you know. It ran its course. And
well, another thing that I think about funding is that obviously the idea of funding is that they're trying to support the creative arts and the music industry. Difficult, struggling industry. They're trying to keep it afloat, obviously. One of the things that I've always thought is it the right thing to support individuals as in artists and bands, or is it a better idea to support the infrastructure, right? So we have almost no good venues to play at in Auckland. And the venues we do have, they've got reflective surfaces everywhere. They often don't have very well thought out stages. They don't have very good PA systems. If they put money into reinforcing venues and giving venues some sort of tax relief, or putting in, you know, arranging some sort of sound specialists or people to design the acoustics properly so they didn't keep getting shut down by noise control, if they made the stage better, the sound on stage better, the experience for the audience is better. If you go to a venue in Auckland these days, most of the time it's so loud you can't hear yourself think. You just want to go outside, you know. It's really hard to develop a fan base if the fan base isn't going to enjoy the show, you know. But no bands or artists can solve that problem themselves. So to me, wouldn't it make more sense if there were things put in place to make things better for the audiences, for the venues, and for the artists across the board that suited everyone? Like, for example, I heard a year or so ago that Seattle have put in place parking, like temporary parking for musicians, like loading bays just for musicians.
Oh, really?
Isn't that a great idea?
That's an awesome idea.
Just putting things in place. I mean, New Zealand's really good at supporting sports, for example, and making sure that they've got everything they need.
Yeah.
Why don't we do the same for music?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Again, when I'm king, I'll fix everything.
I think it's kind of opposite here in Sydney. What they've done in Sydney's taken away parking, especially for musicians late at night, put bloody trams through the middle of Sydney, you know? I mean, it doesn't affect me. Like where I am, I'm out towards Parramatta Way, which is it's about an hour west of actual Sydney City.
Right.
And it's, you know, it's good around here, but I don't know if you've ever heard about the Sydney lockout laws.
I haven't heard about it.
Yeah, okay. So a few years ago there was a few one punch and have you heard of the whole one punch incidents? This young guy was walking through one of the back streets of King's Cross in Sydney, and a guy randomly walked across the road and King hit him, and he hit his head on the ground and he died.
What?
And then this happened again. So what the government ended up doing was create these lockout laws to try and reduce violence in the area. So what that meant was you couldn't go outside of that venue from 1 a.m. and also venues were having to close early.
Right.
It was in this certain precinct of Sydney. And what it has ended up doing is putting so many bars and restaurants and stuff out of business because they can't maintain. They're relying on the patrons coming late. So what that has basically done is like decimate the Sydney live music scene. So
that's ridiculous, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah. So if you get a chance, look it up. Just Google Sydney lockout laws and read a little bit. I'll try and find some stuff and I'll send it to you.
That'd be great. Because I played a few shows in Australia earlier this year. We played in Melbourne and Sydney. And when we were over there, we were hearing about something else that happened. I can't remember the details now. You might know about it. But it affected the festivals. They changed some law that meant that something had to – there was, I don't know, more security had to be provided or something like that, that added this huge expense to festivals, which meant a lot of festivals just said, well, we can't afford to go anymore.
Yeah, it's still happening. The police presence at these festivals now is just so overkill. You know, and I understand what they're trying to do, but the way they're doing it is it's not good.
It feels like a gesture, you know? It feels like there's a problem and they just go, I don't know, let's just do that. And they just don't really think it through and... some random thing applied to everything, it screws everything up for everyone.
Exactly. But, yeah. You know, it gets them re-voted, and, you know, now they're in right. government for 4 more years. And but, I mean, this is politics again. I try not to get too much into it. But,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but basically what I was saying is, the Sydney scene is just not the same.
Yeah. Unfortunately, yeah. I think that's happening in a lot of places, in a lot of different yep. ways.
Right.
You know, I think it's hard in the arts at the moment.
Yeah, right.
And, yeah, I think a lot about it. Not that I've got any solutions, but apart from yep. things like the artists pulling together and the government supporting the infrastructure, that's pretty much all I've got.
Yeah, that's cool, though. Yeah, yeah. And yeah, in saying that with Sydney, too, you know, there's a lot happening behind the scenes, too. There's, as a friend of mine said, there's people setting up their situations. Basically, they're setting up their little music groups and venues and starting these followings. And Sydney music scene, although it's sort of getting a little bit outside of Sydney, it's still growing. It's not like it was, and it never will be like it was unless there's some big change. But, yeah, man, it's cool. Yeah, that's all I've got to say on that, I think.
Yeah, yeah. It's a tough one. Yeah. Eh? There's sort of no end to that conversation.
Yeah, that's right.
And, yeah. And it's like in the middle of all of this, how do you – keep yourself grounded and stay sane and stay positive. And because if you focus on all of the difficult aspects of things, it's easy to just fall down that hole and everything just seems like it's terrible, you know? So how do you stay motivated to still go and make an album or go out and play?
Yeah.
You know, and stay positive. And I think that's for all of us is an ongoing struggle.
Yeah.
But it's really, it's really important.
Yep. Yeah. Totally. Mm. All right, man. So, let's just we'll wrap it up with you got some new music out. The album Hustle Bustle is out in September.
Yep.
The new track, which is out today, well, for us it's today, but for you listening was last week or the week before. I'm not exactly sure the date this is going to come out. Mm-hmm. And that song is called Don't Be Late.
That's right.
The track Hustle Bustle, which was the first single, is fantastic. Go and listen to it. I'll put all the links to those songs and the up-and-coming album and, you know, your website, your podcast, everything.
Yeah.
If you've got some other links you want me to put, just send them over, man, and I'll chuck them in.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Are you thinking of touring the album?
Yes, for sure. Yep. Fantastic. I'm in the middle of putting a show together at the moment.
Okay, fantastic. Well, yeah, yeah,
can't wait.
Yeah, cool. I hope you get to Sydney, and if you get to Sydney, I'll definitely come. It'd be cool.
I definitely want to get to Sydney and Melbourne too. Awesome. I've got some good friends in both places, so I definitely want to head over there. Yeah,
yeah. Melbourne's a cool hub, man. And yeah, you know, even Brisbane, Gold Coast, if you get up there too, there's a good scene up there.
Yeah, yeah. For sure.
Yeah, see all the people.
I would do anything. Like, just, you know, the people with money and power, give me a call.
That's it.
I'll even knock a couple of zeros off my $1 million fee.
don't undercut yourself, man. Don't undercut
yourself.
No.
Yes, you're right. You're absolutely right. Yeah.
Yeah. Danny McCrum, thanks so much for hanging out with me today.
It's been a real pleasure.
Wishing you all the best with your music and the podcast.
Thank you.
So I didn't mention this. So the first time I heard of your podcast, I had Joel Shadbolt on my show.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And I didn't know about your podcast at the time. And then I saw his name come up in your podcast and I went, oh, no, I definitely don't want to be talking about the same stuff. So I went and listened to it. So that was my, yeah, because I don't like to sort of like rerun stuff of people off their podcast, you know?
Yeah, no, I agree.
Yeah. 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 But yeah, really dug it. And
he's a great dude. His band LAB are killer.
They're killing it, man. Yeah, yeah. They're almost sold out their Australian tour.
Have they? Yeah, well, it doesn't surprise me. Every time anyone sees them, they're like, God damn, these guys are good. You
know? Yeah, so, yeah, yeah. He's such a cool laid-back dude. So,
yep,
yeah,
for sure.
So Don't Give Up Your Day Job is the podcast. Hustle Bustle is the new album out September. And like I said, the two singles are out now. Danny McCrum, thanks so much, bro.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate
it, man. Being here. Thank you.
All right. Later, bro. Cheers.
See you later. Cheers. How about slowing down, looking around and thinking things through?
serve ourselves. And it's not that hard to play a part and collect our minds. But we're not having fun till the safety's off. So one way ticket. I got just one life to live.